This program is brought to you by the friends and partners of Time of Grace. Time of Grace with Pastor Mark Jeske is an international Christian outreach ministry that is dedicated to sharing the good news of Jesus Christ with people across the country and around the world. Come and worship with us on Sunday at St. Marcus Lutheran Church, 2215 North Palmer Street, Milwaukee, or become a Grace partner by visiting our website at timeofgrace.org. And now, Time of Grace.
You struggle with how to share your faith effectively? You know, I'd really have to give God points for courage, but also kind of stand agape at the risk he was willing to take. In order to rescue a lost and fallen world, God moves heaven and earth to send his Son to become incarnate, become a human being, go through everything he went through, the suffering, crucifixion, burial, resurrection, and ascension into heaven, and then tells us. And by believing it, we have access to a Savior. But then, he says, you need to connect with other people who don't know it yet. And here's the dilemma. People are born lost. They're born disconnected from God and guilty in their sins. They need to be told so that the Word can heal them. The Word can bring them forgiveness. The Word can give them immortality. How do you and I step up to that amazing task? That's why we need the Holy Spirit. To put down something they didn't like or understand, the same people who crucified Jesus heard the disciples talking in languages they had not studied and were so stressed out, recognized that was such a threat to keep this Jesus movement rolling, they tried to snuff it out. And even though it was 9 in the morning, they started catcalls on Peter and the others. They heard something they could not explain. They heard the gospel message of Jesus Christ, crucified, buried, but risen again. The Easter gospel that guarantees us of all the good things the resurrection brings us to tower over them all, the forgiveness of your sins so that the guilt of your crummy, rotten, sinful life is lifted and you may enjoy your life knowing you have God's favor. That is such a powerful message that only Christ can give it. And the second one is this: though your body will fall apart and disintegrate and go back to the dirt from which it is made, you, through faith, are immortal in Christ, and you will have a resurrection as splendid as his when the time is right. And forgiveness and immortality are the most powerful message in the world. It is the gospel message, and only Jesus can give it, and only the Holy Spirit can arrange for that information to be transmitted accurately, and for it to be heard, for it to be understood, and even more, not only understood, but then believed in. But they didn't want to hear that, and they told Peter and the others, "You're drunk. Go home." It was 9 in the morning. Peter said, "We're not drunk." What made this all the more extraordinary is that there was a sound of a cyclone blowing through Jerusalem, but no buildings fell down, unlike here in our country in cyclone season and twister season. When a twister blows through town, it can take a full-size house and turn it into toothpicks in seconds. But this cyclone blew through Jerusalem. They could hear the wind howling, but nothing was damaged or broken. They just knew something is going on here. They saw fire, which can turn a house into a blackened, charred wreck. But that fire, which can kill people, was giving life. It sat on the heads of the men and the women who were waiting for Jesus to keep his promise. Wind that did not blow down buildings and fire that did not consume and destroy, symbolizing the Spirit was not being dribbled out but gushed out. And the people began to share the message of the Easter gospel, bursting into languages they had not studied. all around the ancient world at that time. In the first two paragraphs of Acts chapter 2, some people made fun of Peter and the apostles, and they said, "They have had too much wine. Go home, you're drunk." And Peter said, "No." He stood up with the 11. They were down one, as you know. Who was missing? Judas, correct. Judas lost interest in further life on this earth. He felt like quite a failure and felt there was no hope for him and took his own life. So now, there were now 11 leaders. He raised his voice and addressed the crowd. "Fellow Jews, and all of you who are in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Now listen carefully to what I say, and you better be listening too. This is life or death for you as well. These men are not drunk, as you suppose. It's only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will," what's the word? "Pour out." Not dribble out, not trickle, not even send. But pour out. There's going to be a gusher of the Spirit, and it's going to be on all people. Now, can I pause here for just a minute? I want to talk about this concept of last days. You will hear that phrase in the Bible. If you do your Bible reading, you will bump into that phrase dozens, probably hundreds of times, and it needs a word of explanation. I think of it as the history of the world as a huge football game, where God has his objectives and he wants to win, and his game basically is in four quarters. And God kind of changed his game plan strategy. The basics are always the same, but the game plan, the strategy would change with each quarter as the coach would go back in the locker room and cook up a different game plan. The first quarter was the game plan of Adam and Eve, and although it started well, it ended very badly, and the rottenness in the people, starting with Cain's vicious murder of his brother, just metastasized and so infected and rotted out the character of the whole human race and destroyed their beliefs that God could see. Not only does earth stink now from the beautiful paradise I've made, I can't stand to endure them any longer. And in fact, evil might just take over the good. I'm going to wash it clean. And he took 8 people, Noah, his wife, his 3 sons, and his 3 daughters-in-law, put them in a giant floating barge and boxed them in. It was a big barge with no steering wheel and no rudder because it had no destination. It didn't need to go anywhere. It didn't need to sail. All the ark had to do was not sink. That was its only mission: keep animals and people alive while the face of the earth goes crazy. And for a month, more than a month, the water came crashing down out of heaven, but it also blew up from underneath. You know, if I can have a little aside here, I'd like to talk about fish for a minute. I used to think that the fish kind of caught a break during the flood. I mean, do fish worry about lots of rain? Not so much, I don't think, do they? But you know, there's a lot more going on than just some heavy rain. During the flood, God blew up the aquifers beneath the surface of the earth. Water not only came down, it came up. When the ocean floor was blowing up with erupting aquifers, firing up all the water from the gigantic caverns beneath, that was a pretty turbulent place for fish too. I have a hunch, I'll check with God when we arrive, but I have a hunch that there was a pretty massive fish kill too, because that violent erupting made under the water not such a safe place. The only safe place anywhere on planet Earth was inside that barge as the people huddled together listening to the crashing all around them. All right, that's the first quarter. It started so well and ended so ugly, ended very badly with the great flood. Quarter two begins and God said, let's start over with Noah. But things began to unravel almost immediately. Noah himself had a deeply flawed character. His boys were worse, and his grandsons, as exemplified by his grandson Canaan, were worse yet. And again, the spiritual fiber of the human race is degrading. It's getting worse. Now, God remembered, I said, no more floods, all right. But as they were trying to build a civilization to them, at the Tower of Babel, God looked at him and saw, you're not worshiping me anymore. What about me? You're all humanists. All you care about is you. And he took the Tower of Babel and scattered them by planting different languages in their brains so that they could not communicate and had to scatter to find other people who were able to speak their brand new languages. You might say there was a nasty Pentecost where people suddenly were speaking languages they had not studied, but they lost the ability to speak their original language and had to scatter to survive. So that second quarter, at halftime, the game ended again very badly with the scattering, with God's judgment coming upon the human race. Quarter three, God said, what am I going to do? Well, I'm going to start over with a family, and I'm going to pour enormous effort into the personal training of the leadership structure, and I'm going to build a nation, but I'm not going to recruit them all at once. I'm going to build it one at a time. And I see I have to put enormous care and parenting into this. So he chose Abraham, already getting pretty old. Abraham already was 75 before God called his name. So don't think of Abraham as some young guy. When God said, you need to move 800 miles for me, Abraham was already, you know, retirement age. He was already getting his pension from the government of Ur of the Chaldees. And was already, you know, looking for a nice place to retire with Sarah. And God said, you need to move. And by the way, all this land that you're looking at in this new place will be yours, and it'll belong to your descendants. Don't argue with me, infertile man and your infertile wife. Don't argue with me. It's going to be from a child coming out of your own body. And then God made him wait for 25 years. Sarah didn't get pregnant till Abraham was 99. And she was a sweet menopausal 89. And God said, now that you know you can't, now you're ready for me to do it. And little miracle boy, Isaac, was born. So God built a nation, sometimes very disobedient, but the plan worked enough. His third quarter plan worked well enough that when the fullness of time had come, when the third quarter was over and it was time for Christ to come, there was a believing, faithful remnant still worshiping in Jerusalem, still reading the scriptures, the Hebrew Old Testament scriptures, still observing the sacrifices, still waiting for the coming of the Messiah. It's a small little piece on earth, but God got enough traction out of that group that he said, we can go forward to the fourth quarter. Christ is born, Christ lived, and then gathered with his disciples on that upper room Maundy Thursday evening and told them that the quarter's ending and that the last days are about to begin. Jesus gave his disciples the last Passover meal, the first supper. The old days are coming to an end. I'm going to be leaving now, but the last quarter is going to begin with an explosion of the Holy Spirit. You're going to have more, not less. My ascension is not a disaster. It's a kickstarter to accelerate the fourth quarter. We're coming out and we're bringing game because the Spirit's going to be poured out. And Joel said that was going to come. Jesus' disciples should not have been such a hard sell. They should have known the prophets said that these days would happen. Here's what Joel had said many centuries earlier. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my Spirit on all people. Sons and daughters will prophesy. Here, prophesying, not necessarily in the sense of predicting the future, but in the sense of just relating the great works of God. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. On all my servants, men and women, I will not dribble out, not put little drops on your head, but I will pour out my Spirit in those days. In the last quarter, they are going to prophesy. And one of the features of the last quarter of God's game plan is that there is a universal priesthood of all believers. Every one of you, where no matter geographically where you're from, no matter linguistically what you speak as your first language, no matter what your gender, male or female, no matter what your age, old men and young men, old women and young women, you are all royal priests of God, able to communicate with God through your Savior Jesus, the way that only the priest used to be able to do, able to offer spiritual sacrifices pleasing to your God, and you are authorized communicators and sharers of the Easter gospel. It is my job to be sure, and I love it, but it is your job as well. All of us have been given Jesus' job, and his ascension into heaven is also your commissioning to fulfill what Joel said was going to happen. At the end of the last quarter, here's a little heads up why this matters. I will show wonders in the heaven above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The earth as we know it, when the final buzzer goes off on God's clock, this earth is going to be destroyed as we know it. Everything tangible is going up in smoke, just like Sodom and Gomorrah. The only thing you can take out of here is yourself and other people that you have connected with and shared the gospel with. All your stuff is going up in smoke. God will compensate you. He's going to give you new stuff in the next age, but nothing tangible or material can come along with you. Only people are immortal and will survive what you're reading about here. When the fourth quarter comes to an end and we don't know how many digits are left on God's digital clock, could be today, you and I might be still living when we see the blood and fire, billows of smoke, the light of the sun turned off into darkness, the moon's white light at night getting dark and blood red, scaring the bejesus out of everybody looking up, wondering what is happening to our immutable universe. Before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord. It's glorious for me. I can't wait. It'll be glorious for you because you're not afraid. It'll be a day of hell. It'll be the first day of hell for people who are not connected to Christ. Why? Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Everyone who does not call on the name of the Lord will be condemned. That's why we need the Spirit. Only the Spirit can communicate the right information because nobody has it by nature. Nobody knows Jesus by birth. It has to be given to you. And God uses people to give it to people. Though he could, I suppose, shout the name of Christ from on high, I suppose he could have his angels do skywriting just like jets up in the sky, or those skywriting planes kind of go around and leave little puffs of white smoke and put messages, or he could have a fleet of angels towing around banners. You know how sometimes above stadiums some advertising gig has a plane slowly going round and round dragging a message banner behind it. God could do that, I suppose, but he chooses not to. He limits himself to his plan A, which is his only plan, and that is you and me. We are the tellers of the name of Jesus, and the Spirit's power goes with us to do two powerful and important things. Thing one, reveal the truth about Christ. Here is the truth. This little paragraph that follows sums it up. Men of Israel, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs. God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. He was handed over to you by God's set purpose and foreknowledge. You, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him on a cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death. And as I mentioned before, the so what in that story is through faith now his resurrection gives you the forgiveness of your sins and gives you the immortality of your body. And that wonderful promise sustains us that no matter what this broken world throws at us, we have got joy in knowing we have God's favor and love and smile now. We can enjoy our lives without fear. We can enjoy people. We can be patient and forgiving of other people as God has been patient and forgiving with us. And we know that even as our physical body grows weaker, fails, and even dies, it is nothing but a transition to a glorious new life where we get the ultimate mulligan, the ultimate do-over, and we get to enter the new life that God is going to build. This now is our great commission, our great joy, to share that good news with everybody. Every one of you has had the Spirit of the Lord put in you. Every one of you has gifts. Every one of you has been authorized and empowered by God to share this message within your circle of friends and relationships. And there are people that perhaps will listen only to you. Around each of your heads are the pictures of people in your circle that perhaps you alone can really connect with. And if they think about now of the people you know who are not right at this moment today able to call on the name of the Lord Jesus and be saved. Think of the people you may be sick about seeing caught up in the angels who are going to be arresting and dragging off unbelievers into condemnation. Think about the people you know that may be ready to listen to you and watch and listen for your opportunity. They need forgiveness of their sins, for everybody feels that guilt. Everybody has rottenness and depression inside, afraid of the day of accountability they all know is coming, but don't know what to do about it. And you may be just the woman, or just the man, or just the kid who's able to say, don't worry, Jesus loves you. There's forgiveness even for such a big fool as you. You may know people who push him off early in life, but as they see their body declining, their fear of death starts to creep in and trouble their heart. You can say that there is resurrection and immortality. Call on the name of Jesus now. Let him bring his forgiveness to your heart. Let him, through the power of the Holy Spirit, put faith in his wonderful promises and call on the name of Jesus now before it's too late. By the time that the buzzer goes off and the moon does its blood red thing and the sun's light begins to go out and the fire and the billows of smoke start to burn up the physical universe, it will be too late. So sad, too bad. Now is the time for sharing, and Pentecost is the day to claim everything the Spirit gives you to fit you out for that incredible life and soul-saving mission, that adventure that He has called you to be part of. This is a splendid, splendid promise for all of the royal priests of God. He honors you with that dignity to be His message sharers, so that the amazing miracle of the Holy Spirit released at Pentecost may still be poured out today. Let it be poured out into you and through you in your world. Let all God's people say, Amen. Here's a question that might bring up something that you have already experienced. Every time I try to talk to my wife about Jesus, she totally shuts me down. Could you please pray for her? That one's an easy part. That part's an automatic yes. I'm afraid to mention anything anymore, but I'm even more afraid that I won't see her in heaven someday. So the real question behind that one is, how do you talk to someone in your home who is hostile to the idea of the gospel message? What do you do? What have you done at times like that? How do you talk to people in your friend circle or in your circle of relatives who maybe grew up without the Lord and sort of are nervous or hostile or resistant to that? Well, first of all, wait for your right times. People don't want you coming at them like as though you're a salesperson hustling something or pushing something they don't want. Earn the right to be listened to. And one of the ways you do that is by showing a listening ear to that person on what's important for him or her. Another thing is keep it short. Know and do your homework and know how to summarize the gospel message in a brief way. Don't go on and on and on and on. And lastly, I would say always go from the standpoint of grace, not here's what you must do to clean up your life. But that makes no sense until the Lord Jesus is living inside a person. And that only happens through the message of God's unconditional love. I'll be back to pray with you for that unconditional love in just a minute.
We would like to send you the Grace Moments devotional for July through September. Pastor Mark has written 90 devotions for your daily quiet time with God. Each devotion has a scripture verse and is available for your best gift. Call Time of Grace at 800-661-3311 or visit timeofgrace.org/store to request your own copy or one to share with a friend.
You and I are able to have this conversation today because of the miracle of mass media technology and also through the generosity of the friends and partners of Time of Grace. Here's a big thank you from my heart to yours to all of you whose regular ongoing financial gifts make the broadcasts of Time of Grace possible. If you haven't become a Grace partner yet, let me invite you today to pray and consider joining the team and becoming my partner in helping our country and the world hear good news of Jesus through God's amazing Word. I want you to know that the new Grace Moments quarterly is out, not just the old monthly style, the little mini booklets, but these are for a whole quarter, 90 daily devotions to perk up your day and dial you in more to God's wonderful blessings for your life. It's yours for a gift, your best gift. Just get in touch with us. I'd like each of you to have your own copy of Grace Moments for the third quarter of this year, from July through September. Should we pray together? Let's come and ask God for His love and His help. Heavenly Father, we ask You to give us courage to be able to speak Your words. How much it means to us that somebody helped us understand and grow in the Word. Use us as Your partners and communicators. Lord Jesus, it's all about You. Help us always to put You at the center of our communication. Holy Spirit, the wisdom and the power come from You. We depend on You to help us in our personal witnessing. Blessed Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. For Time of Grace, I'm Pastor Mark Jeske. Every day is a day of God's amazing grace for you.
Helping you reach the next level of your Christian life is a driving passion for Mark Jeske and the ministry team at Time of Grace. When you visit timeofgrace.org, you'll find more resources than ever, including video extras, social media connections, new products, plus our prayer ministry, all at timeofgrace.org. And pray about becoming a Grace Partner, an exclusive group of partners and donors who are committed to help us expand Mark Jeske's teaching ministry around the world. Just call 1-800-661-3311 or visit us at timeofgrace.org. Thanks for watching. And join us again next time for Mark Jeske and Time of Grace.
This program has been brought to you by the friends and partners of Time of Grace. Time of Grace with Pastor Mark Jeske is recorded in Milwaukee and is an international Christian outreach ministry that is dedicated to sharing the good news of Jesus Christ with people across the country and around the world. Come and worship with us on Sunday at St. Marcus Lutheran Church, 2215 North Palmer Street, Milwaukee. Or become a Grace Partner by visiting our website at timeofgrace.org.